Friends in the US, a very good morning. Welcome to day five of the NASSCOM US Week 2020. The last 4 days have been incredible, I must say. Amazing programs. We tried to make it as good as possible as a face-to-face program, as you all know. A huge thank you to all of you, all our members who have taken out time to attend the program. I'm sure you would have found it valuable. I'm getting a lot of queries, and what we plan to do is, at the end of the program today, we will then respond to all the queries after we've collated that. So big thank you for, coming back to us on your specific queries, and we will, take that up. We started, as you know, the first day with Texas, then went on to Rhode Island, then we did North Carolina, and yesterday we had Indiana. And in a lighter vein, I was looking at the program, and not that it was planned, but we had two Democrat states and two Republican states. So we've been absolutely bipartisan, to say the least. And today, it's something which is in which it's a horizontal. So, and thankfully we had governors from all the states, Secretary of Commerce, and then we had end users talking about their digital transformation journey in terms of how they have been able to pivot, giving us an idea in terms of how we need to access some of those opportunities. Launchpad, low-cost incubation models, all of that have been discussed, and an absolute commitment from those four states that we've been there. And as you know, it's been a logical progression. Last year, where we had visited across, 10, programs across different parts of the U.S. And a very successful launchpad launch in New Jersey. So we hope to do a lot on this, these programs, and obviously the feedback from you is going to be very, very critical. And what we aim to do is to, have a discussion with select people who are, more advanced in their thought process on how to access or grow in the US market. Today is great. We have KNAV, our partners who have been partnering us. They were there in the UK with us, and the feedback was excellent. And we felt that, while we were looking at navigating the states and looking at opportunities in various states, we needed to look at the go-to-market strategy that, companies have. And the go-to-market strategy is very much based on how you want to progress. And both organic and inorganic is something, which is going to be really, really critical. And to expand the horizon, in terms of regulatory, legal, accounting, tax, a lot of those questions that you have, which you probably have not had the chance to ask, but are extremely critical. Some companies say, should we have our setup in Delaware? Some companies talk about different states. Some companies say that, we are present in this state, but how can we access the opportunities in the other state if we have a setup in one state? Regulatory, legal, tax, all of that, as well as looking at organic and inorganic mechanisms to grow is another option. So KNAV is going to, provide detailed inputs on all these things. And, you will have the opportunity to ask, questions from experts at KNAV, KNAV our partners, for the session today. I also want to thank Mayank and Saurabh and Kuntra from my team who have worked super, super hard to make this possible. So, big thank you to them as well. In terms of, the program, we also have practitioners who have seen it all and done it all. So we have, the M&A folks, from Tech Mahindra, as well as Persistent, who will give their thoughts and share their ideas on how you could look at the market, given the fact that, they have done it successfully. And we thought it'll be good for you to kind of, not only hear from the people who help you do it, but the people who've done it. So that will, you know, comprise the session today. And again, thank you so much, everyone, for joining. I hope you're all keeping yourself safe and healthy. That's priority number one. And look forward to a very, very exciting session today. So without much ado, over to Vaibhav, who's a partner with KNAV, to take the session forward. Thanks, everyone. Vaibhav.
Well, thank you very much, Shivinder. And at the outset, thank you to NASSCOM for the last 4 days and the wonderful sessions that have been hosted. I think we have reached a point in our lives where a epidemic like COVID-19 has taught businesses, professional service firms, general, you know, Indo-US corridor businesses to think differently. And what we felt was our endeavor would be today to look at what are the organic ways of growing in business in the US. If you are already in the US, how should you grow faster? If you want to be in US, what are the structures available? How should one think about a real business model? And including there, a very clear way to grow is inorganic growth. So we're going to spend a good amount of time on acquisitions, mergers, the inorganic side of doing business. My role today will be to moderate this session. I'm going to start off on the organic growth side, share some experience over the last 20 odd years that we have been advising businesses, especially Indian businesses, to practice and to grow in the US. I will be, you know, joined by a very elite panel. We have, you know, Biplab and Saurabh, you know, led M&A, large M&A deals and transactions. And Biplab is from Tech Mahindra, Saurabh from Persistent. I also have, you know, professionals and my colleagues in the firm, Atul Deshmukh, who leads our assurance practice. He'll throw some interesting light on nuances of accounting and things that you watch out for so that your EBITDA is well taken care of if you have an earn-out structure. And, you know, various kind of complexities that arise and how do you simplify thinking around accounting for acquisitions. I have Shishir. Shishir Lagu leads our US tax practice. Shishir will, you know, focus both organic and inorganic side of business, the US tax nuances. What is the maze there? How does one navigate to plan a business growth, both organic? And when you're looking at acquisitions, when you're looking at consolidations, what is the right way to think? And again, what could be some pitfalls and challenges? So Shishir will cover all of that. Then we have Rajesh Khairajani. Rajesh leads the valuations practice, and he has been advising a lot of corporates on how do you think about valuations, special considerations around contingent earnout models, how does one think differently when you are really looking at a pure play acquisition, how will your balance sheet get impacted, what are impairment issues when we look at Indo-US business models. And the goal will be to keep it interactive. We have a session towards the end on Q&A. Feel free to put your questions on the chat panel. As a moderator, I have the privilege of getting all these questions. You know, I've been told my colleagues in NASSCOM will, you know, keep putting them up. We will, for the sake of good order, leave the questions towards the end so that the right speakers can address those. With that opening comments, let me get into some interesting organic growth aspects. And I want to start with this whole thought that today we are facing disruption. And as a firm, the businesses that we are advising, the common theme and the common refrain we are seeing is that growth will come to businesses who are willing to disrupt themselves. Well, some may argue survival is also akin to growth, but yet one has to take that bold step. If you are only in India, you are doing business with the US, but you don't have a presence in US, should you think about an organic growth? Should you think about a setup in US? It could be a marketing entity to start with. It could be a sales and distribution setup. It could be a partnership with a local agent or an individual. How should you think about doing business in US? Right? So at the end of the day, it's very important that the status quo doesn't need to continue. There are amazing opportunities. And if you see some data out here, when I look at US, and this is March 2020 data, the top 10 trading partners of US, India is in the top 10 list. Okay, India, you know, exports about, you know, 14 billion. So US is importing 14 billion worth of goods, and this number keeps going up. And US exports about 8.5 billion to India. Now this data, obviously, you know, every year we see an increasing trend. And a $23 billion total trade. And these are excluding some of the larger marquee FDI transactions. These are pure trading numbers that I'm seeing. And we think we'll keep going north in this list as India progresses in its equation. And I think even with the change in leadership in the US, the bilateral partnership between US and India will ensure that the pricing, the import structure in US, all of that should benefit us. So I think in that context, we are right up there. Now, when one looks at Indo-US trade, one, you know, when we start up a US business, we always look at our Indian clients and we tell them, have you thought about having an entity in the US? Have you thought about a business presence in the US? It's one thing to say I'm exporting from India into the US, but clearly, you know, customers want to see a presence. They like to see a US invoice. They like to see that as an India entity, although we've been doing business, do you have somebody in US whom I can talk to? Should you have a larger marketing presence? You know, it's one thing to go and attend conferences, exhibitions, trade shows, and say that here is, you know, this is what I can do. Here is how we are different in our technology offering, and, you know, have the knowledge marketing around it. But clearly, data has shown us that almost 80% of our clients over a period of time have migrated to a US presence. So when I say US presence, we are talking about setting up an entity in the US. And clearly going in from India, if you're not there, there are three options that you really have. You have, and this is the Reserve Bank of India, FEMA kind of terminology. The first one is a wholly owned subsidiary where you do 100% equity ownership, equity investment into US, right? Then you have a partnership model or a joint venture model where you work with an existing partner in US. And the third is, and again, still relevant even in Indian context when you're entering into the in the US for the first time, is a branch office where you don't really need to incorporate a company. You extend, if you are in Mumbai or you are in Bangalore or Pune, you go and set up a New York branch or a Chicago branch or a branch in California, for example, right? That's an extension of your operations. So these are the three typical models that we have seen when an India entity wants to go to the US. Now, when you select the first one and when you say wholly owned subsidiary, you're basically talking about, you know, setting up a corporation. Now, there are two types of corporation. One is, of course, a C corporation, which is nothing but an India private limited company that you go and set up in the US. And then you have a limited liability corporation or LLC. Now, the essential difference between the two is a tax difference. Now, a typical US corporation gets taxed at the corporate level, whereas a limited liability company, by definition, it's a pass-through entity. So the tax can flow through to the individual members. Now, if you are coming in from India, clearly you will elect to tax as a corporation there. And to that extent, the LLC is now subject to US taxes because the owners are sitting outside. Now, that is one way to think. The other way to think is, what is better for me? I am a technology company in India. I want to be there for the first time. I may want to attract investors. I may have a banking requirement. I may want to borrow and leverage. I may want to enter into partnerships. Now, in each of these cases, if you are going to get equity partners and investors, they prefer a C corporation. And C corporation is preferred for multiple other reasons between an LLC and a C corp. But one of the key reasons is when you're incorporating, you want to have stock certificates. You want to have bylaws of the entity, and you want to have a shareholders agreement between individuals who are owning the businesses, if you are going to have partners, and even keep a room for investors coming in. And when you're talking about both C-Corp or LLC, I think one basic question that we get is, where do we form? Where do we incorporate? Now, the state of Delaware is a state that we have always looked at and recommended. Now, there are multiple options that you can choose. You don't need to necessarily pick up New York or Chicago, or I mean, Illinois or California or Delaware. It's really driven by your business needs. But when you have to choose, when you really don't care where you are incorporated, you need a physical office in New York or all of that, still a Delaware structure is always preferred. And there are some reasons. Delaware has a chancery court, which is an 1882 court, 140 years of corporate history. Investors prefer investing in a Delaware corp. Bankers prefer dealing with Delaware businesses. And the reason there is, I think, both from a liability perspective and from corporate officers, you know, the shareholders perspective, Delaware laws have been tried and tested in the Chancery Court for over 140 years. What it means is you don't have to wait for a New Jersey court, a federal or a district court there to take its own time, think what should apply. The things move very, very fast. And that is why investors prefer Delaware. The Chancery Court is a special purpose court that essentially focuses on corporate issues. Other than that, of course, the main model of Delaware is incorporation. If you say Goa is for tourism, we equate Delaware is for incorporation. You have expedited filings. The state makes it a very low cost affair. You don't need to pay any corporate income tax in Delaware if you are doing business in another state. And I think in terms of privacy protection, in terms of online filings, it's an easy state to do business in. So that's one clear reason why I would think Delaware would score. Again, going from India, I would also want to kind of bring about a very nuanced application of the law, and that is FEMA, or the Foreign Exchange Management Act. It is very important that you think through how do you want to structure this from India into US. So clearly, if you select a C Corp or an LLC, earlier, there were specific approvals required from your AD, the authorized dealer bank, under the Reserve Bank of India guidelines. Thankfully, those have all been done away with. Today, it's automatic approval. Up to 400% of your net worth, or four times your net worth, you are allowed to invest or remit money from India into the US. So that's a pretty good limit that RBI has set. Once you do that, and as you are incorporating, you select a state, file your documents, you are up and running with the bank account in less than a week if you select the right bank. One need not travel to the US to open a bank account. There are banks which will recognize your India setup, take your KYCs and open your bank accounts. And then when you travel there, you can complete the rest of the formalities, but your accounts will still be open. You can operate. And then you start running the businesses, ensuring your compliance is always in place. This is literally a roadmap of organic growth. How do you get in the US? How do you think about a state, incorporate your company, and then run the business? Friends, all of this can be accomplished within a week if you plan well. Today, at Delaware C Corporation, we can open as we speak in this session. By the time we complete the session, we can get you up and running with a Delaware Corporation. That's the speed at which US works. Of course, you have to think this through. You have to ensure that all the aspects of doing business you have thought through, and then you incorporate. Because you don't want to go back and make changes. You don't want to change the state offer. It's an important decision. Also very important is to understand the tax aspect and the tax nuances of doing business in the US. And for this, I'm going to pause and I'm going to invite my colleague Shishir Lagu to take us through the tax and regulatory considerations when we do business in the US. Shishir, over to you.
Thanks, Arnav. So in the US, we generally have the income tax, payroll taxes, property taxes, sales use tax, custom duty. As far as income tax is concerned, currently the tax rate is 21%. The interesting part is that the US has a three-tier system of taxation. So they have a federal tax, state tax, as well as certain cities like the New York and Philadelphia do impose their own income tax. Given that it's important to view where you want to do the business, because the income tax can be an important driver. Whilst, like I said, the federal rate is 21%, the state rate can anywhere be in the range of 4% to 10%, which means that your effective tax rate can anywhere be in the range of 25 to 30%. Over and above that, if the city is imposing an income tax, your ETR can still go higher. Having said that, this is a position as it stands today, but now with Joe Biden coming in as a president, and there is a certain tax policy change which we can expect in the time to come. He has already laid down certain aspects of this tax policy, and the two important ones which I would like to cover here. One is an increase in the corporate tax rate. So he clearly has mentioned that he would want to increase the rate from 21 to 28%, which means that the effective tax rate, including the state taxes, can now go from anywhere in the range of 32% to 40%. So that's going to be a big change. Another interesting thing what he is coming up with is a carrot and a stick approach for making America movement. So whilst on one hand is saying that, okay, if you are offshoring your manufacturing and service jobs to outside of the US, he is looking at something like a 10% surtax, which will anyways take your federal tax rate from 28% to 30.8%. And on the other hand, if you kind of restore the production, increase more and more jobs in the US to give you a 10% job tax kind of a credit. So there is clearly a policy change which is more looking towards make in America, have more jobs in America. And it will surely have an impact on the overall outsourcing, both on the tangible products as well as for the technology companies in terms of the getting the services from outside of the country. Having said that, there are another two aspects which one must consider. One is how you really want to invest. So whilst Vaibhav covered the legal part of it in terms of the C Corp or an LLC or a branch and so on, the important aspect can also be whether I want to set up a company in the US to hold the another entity in the US, or whether I want to directly hold a US company from the India parent company. Some may look at some fancy structures like intermediate holding company. So whether I want to hold a US entity through the intermediate holding company, let's say a UK or a Netherlands and so on. Now, each of these structure has got its own pros and cons, and one must really examine them in the light of the US domestic law as well as the tax treaty to see how they really want to hold the structure. We often get the questions as to, okay, I mean, we don't really want to do business directly, but we are looking at a joint venture. Now, in those cases, whether we can hold the investment directly from India or whether we should still set up an entity in the US. Again, a thought from a tax perspective, based on the capital gain implications in US and so on. So looking at the investment structure is a very important point. When you look at the funding, debt and equity are generally the two important aspects. So when you look at the debt, how would the interest deductibility work in the US? So if it is a related party interest payment, the interest is deductible only on the payment basis, which can create a timing difference in terms of deductibility in the US vis-a-vis income inclusion in India. So it can have an impact on your ETR. Similarly, there are stringent thin capitalization rules, and that's where it's extremely important that you are reasonable about and in terms of balancing the debt equity structure in the US. Another important point which sometimes you need to keep in mind is if you have the third party loans, but those are guaranteed by your India parent and you are charging a guarantee fee. Even the guarantee fee is subject to 30% withholding tax in the US. So there are several considerations one must consider when setting a right debt equity structure when they are kind of starting the business in the US. Thanks, and over to you, Weber.
Thanks, Shishir. We have started getting questions and I'm inclined to answer a couple of them right away because they're very topical. The first one was on bank account. Randhir Prakash, the question is whether the bank account can be opened without visiting the US, which bank, what is the process? The answer is yes, Randhir, like I mentioned. So, people recognize that you can't travel today, you still want to do business. So there are banks like Signature Bank, which will open up an account. You, of course, have to go through a firm which they are comfortable with they have worked with, and we are happy to help you there. The process is simple. You go to decide what bank account suits your needs, and then we will kind of get them to send the forms across. You have to pass, have your resolutions ready, have the board meeting approvals, and then once you do your KYC, the bank account gets opened within a week or even lesser. Everything is online. You have to do electronic signatures online, scan some documents, and you'll be good. Again, the process is very quick. We have a couple of questions on tax. Shishir, would you want to quickly cover those? So one question was, this is from IOP Technologies. Is it required to file federal/state tax returns for Delaware LLC, even if there is no business for non-resident cases? So you've just started up, and is it required to therefore, file federal returns?
Sure. So yes, the answer is for the federal, yes. I mean, generally, that's what we recommend. So even if you have not started the business, and I'm assuming here that you have set up an LLC in the US to be taxed as a C Corp for tax purposes, in that case, we would suggest at least to file a nil return with the federal. Given that, like we said, I mean, there is no income tax in Delaware if you are not doing business in Delaware. So you may not really be required to file any state return if you don't have any business, but federal return is recommended.
Shishir, there's one more quick question. This is on the Biden tax proposals. What will be the fate of BEAT when surtax is planned? And as BEAT is also to discourage outsourcing.
Sure. So yeah, I mean, that's a very interesting question, and we don't know what the fate of BEAT will be. And there is no mention in the Biden proposal with respect to whether the BEAT will be eliminated if this surtax comes in. But if I have to just draw a corollary from the guilty aspect of it, so even under guilty, there are certain nuances with respect to it. It's more for a US parent and foreign subsidiary relations, but there also, I mean, it is more to do with having higher profits in the CFCs and then subjecting it to tax on an immediate basis in the US. So whilst this surtax may still be relevant even in those circumstances, because the businesses are being, services are rendered from outside of the US. In fact, Biden says that, okay, he will increase the GILTI from 10.5% to the full 21%, and he is making it all the more stringent. So I don't know whether there is any relief which is coming in under BEAT with the addition of this surtax. It may still go hand in hand.
Thanks, Shishir. All right, I think it was a good overview, and we are going to take more questions towards the end. It's important to keep the flow, and happy to answer as many as we can. And with that, friends, let's move on to the inorganic side of the business. We are going to spend a lot more time here. There are interesting nuances of doing business inorganically. Just some latest data that we wanted to share with everybody today. You know, if you look at the number of deals, okay, even in COVID times, the interesting statistic is that the business is clearly showing a rebound. If we look at the data for Q3, July to September 2020, US rebound, in deal volume, 23%, value also 7%, which clearly shows that, we are, at least from a US perspective, we are looking beyond coronavirus in that sense. Beyond Q4 19, we have now seen a clear value accretion. The deal value just for the quarter three is $280 billion, over 1,600 deals. And if one looks at the entire year, we are talking over 6,000 deals just in the first three quarters. We think that 2020, we will end in the US with over 7,500 deals. Friends, that just shows you the volume of M&A activity that's happening and why M&A is an important way to grow, if one chooses well. And we have a lot of aspects of M&A that we are going to discuss. If you look at the technology segment, I think technology, in fact, from an India outbound perspective, again, it was half the deal volumes, over 29 deals, fairly decent sized deals that we saw. And I think the preferred segment, of course, IT solutions and software development remain, but data analytics, artificial intelligence, big data generated a lot of high deal values. So I think in terms of the deal street, people are looking at planning their ventures inorganically very well. There's a lot of traction. And I think the reasons are very clear. Some of the trends that we are seeing is that consolidation is the key, both to growth and to survival. At the end of the day, you don't want to just keep competing with people. I think collaboration, aggregation seems to be the preferred choice over competition. Right. And again, from a core expertise perspective, if you have additional skills coming on board, better team members coming on board, I think one can grow faster and survive. There's no question there. One other dynamic, and we're going to discuss that, what does it mean from a valuation standpoint, from an accounting standpoint, from a tax standpoint, is earn-out construct. We are seeing more and more businesses looking at more and more earnouts. Recently, we saw transactions even at 15% upfront payment and then a three-year earnout, or for 51% and then a 49% two-year earnout. At least that's the minimum. We feel the earnout period might get extended from the conventional 2 years. It is going to north of 3 years. Even the constructs are very well and very interestingly drafted. So what happens when there's a contingent consideration? So we will have our expert panel talk about all the nuances there. One other interesting dynamic that we have seen, and this is again data, the deal multiples, of course, have seen correction. So today, one can get very high quality businesses, high quality assets at a lower price. So clearly, while the value expectation is there, the bridge between the gap is narrowing. And the last thing I wanted to say is that the diligence depth has increased. I think there's a lot more focus on hardcore fundamentals, and I think that augurs well from a business model point of view. And you know, just with all of us, some of us working from home, I think some of the cultural issues of the deals are also changing. I think from work from home and work from office, work from anywhere seems to be becoming a new norm. And acqui-hire, you know, looking at the right team members, again, is a big trend. So let's understand some of these nuances from all our experts here in the room. And let me start with the accounting aspects. You know, what really happens when one looks at accounting when it comes to an acquisition? What are certain interesting nuances? And to talk to us about it, we have Atul Deshmukh. Atul, would you want to share some latest thoughts on, you know, when you're acquiring a target, what are the steps? What are some nuances that the audience should know? So over to you, Atul.
Thanks, Vaibhav. And, you know, I guess it's been a very interesting session up till now with the contributions that, you know, you and Shishir have made. Obviously, one of the aspects that comes in when you make an acquisition always is with respect to how do you account for that acquisition. And when it comes to acquiring a company, the most important distinction that we typically make is as to who is the acquirer and who is the acquiree. So identifying the acquirer in very simple terms, the company which basically gains control of the other company, that is typically deemed to be the acquirer. So we start with identifying the acquirer. After, you know, identifying the acquirer, in, you know, people who have done, you know, enough deals must have seen the three-step process. You first go into an LOI, a letter of intent, you know, then after that, you do the due diligence and so on. And then you move to the SPA stage, which is basically putting together a share purchase agreement or an asset purchase agreement. And once that is completed, then there is a typical closing date. The closing date is the date on which normally companies will acquire the assets, the acquirer will acquire the assets, the liabilities are assumed, the consideration is paid off. And that is what typically is the date, which is from an accounting perspective treated to be the acquisition date. So that date becomes the date from which the company, if you are actually acquiring more than 50%, then the acquired company becomes a subsidiary of a parent company. The third aspect, which we always look at when we look at accounting considerations, is with respect to the two steps which are there. The first step is of recognizing the identifiable assets acquired, the liabilities assumed, and also any non-controlling interest in the acquiry. So first you recognize all the identifiable assets. When we talk about identifiable assets, we are talking about both tangible and intangible assets. We'll also be talking about goodwill. So the first part is to recognize all of those. The second part, which is an accounting nuance, which comes in is with respect to measuring those assets acquired, those liabilities assumed, and also the non-controlling interest. So there are some interesting aspects which one needs to kind of, you know, consider. Obviously, the fair value method is the acquisition method, which is promulgated by US GAAP. But there are certain exceptions to the fair value method too. So when we talk about income taxes on the date of acquisition, now those are measured. So after recognizing, we come to the measurement. So when we come to the measurement, income taxes are measured as per ASC 740. If we look at pension liabilities, pension assets, now those are recognized as per ASC 715. So there would be differences. One needs to keep in mind that there are nuances and differences when it comes to measuring the assets acquired and the liabilities assumed. You might have certain contingencies, and I'm not talking about contingent consideration here. If you are talking about contingencies which are present on the date of the acquisition, but they cannot be appropriately measured because there is not adequate evidence and information that is available, then in that case, you would not probably fair value it on the date of the acquisition. And finally, you know, once you arrive at what are the identified assets, what is their, you know, measurement, what are the liabilities assumed, what is the measurement, what is the value of the non-controlling interest, once all of that is adequately valued, then we come to the residual, which is recognizing and measuring either goodwill or a gain from a bargain purchase. So there is a possibility that you might have basically paid a consideration which is less than what is the fair value of the assets acquired, and in which case you might actually have a gain from a bargain purchase. So the recognition and measurement of goodwill or gain from a bargain purchase is the last step which occurs with respect to accounting for acquisitions. Now we can look into some additional aspects. The rule of thumb when it comes to non-controlling interest is that if a financial instrument is treated as equity in the books of a subsidiary, then in that case, it would be treated as a non-controlling interest or equity in the books of the parent. So normally when we talk about non-controlling interest, these are our minority shareholders or the non-majority shareholders who are not owning or who are not controlling the acquiree. So that is what we talk about when we talk about non-controlling interest. As per US GAAP, there is only one methodology, and that is the fair value method, which is adopted. Since we have people from India and we are talking about Ind AS and IFRS 2 at some points here, so there would be two measures which could be used. You could either use the fair value method, or there might be an opportunity for, you know, for companies to also use another method where they can actually choose to use the carrying value of the acquiree's net assets for also measuring their non-controlling interest. I don't know how many of you have heard about push-down accounting, but this is again something which is more of a US GAAP, you can call it, terminology, and not typically seen under IFRS. But we talked about the step up in terms of the fair value of the assets acquired in an acquisition. Now, usually, when you continue with the books of accounts of the subsidiary, you will continue those books of accounts at the carrying value, and the step up in the fair value of the acquired assets, the assumed liabilities, all of that is done during the consolidation of the books of the subsidiary with the parent. So at the consolidation level is when we basically account and basically put down in the financial statements the step up in the value. But there might be some specific situations. There might be certain special considerations wherein a company might decide to push down the step up in the value into the books of the subsidiary or the acquired entity. And that is what is called as push down accounting. In case of push down accounting, logically what you would normally see would be that there would be then goodwill, which would actually be there on the set of the subsidiary financial statements. You would also see identified intangible assets, because of which you would see a higher level of amortization. You could see contingent consideration being pushed down into the books of the subsidiary, because of which there might be certain interesting aspects which might come in. So that's a certain angle, a nuance of accounting when it comes to acquisitions, and that is with respect to push down accounting. Not that we see it everywhere, but that is something which we need to keep in mind. We also, speak about, there are certain situations and, cases where one has to determine whether the acquisition itself is a business. So normally we talk about business, we talk about, three parts, correct? Which make up a business. So there have to be, input, processes, and output. So if all the three elements are there, or at least two of the elements are there, then normally you will have a business, and then you will treat it as a business combination under ASC 805. But there might be situations where you're not actually acquiring a business, but you are just acquiring assets. And when it comes to assets, then we have to make the distinction that the cost accumulation model will apply. When you do an asset acquisition, in that case, what then happens is that you basically then account for those assets at the cost of acquisition and whatever might be the direct transaction cost that would be incurred with respect to that particular set of assets, you will also capitalize them along with the cost of acquisition. But when we talk about a business, you know, combination and acquisition of a business, which is not, and again, please don't confuse the fact that you might have an asset purchase acquisition, which could still be a business, but you could just be going out and maybe acquiring a particular brand. And along with that brand, you may not be acquiring any of the other aspects, neither the input nor the processes or the output, in which case you might just treat it as an independent asset acquisition. And that is what where we will use the cost accumulation model. Finally, there is one more nuance which comes in, and where transactions actually take place between the owners of a company. So you might have a parent and it has got two subsidiaries, and there might be transactions by which you merge the two subsidiaries. And in those cases, we then define those transactions as common control transactions. You could have asset transactions under common control, or you could have even business transactions which come under common control. Important to note that common control transactions are not covered under ACA 805, which is for business combinations. And typically, common control transactions normally always occur at the carrying value. So usually you would not have, and you would typically, you know, frankly, not have any gain or loss in respect to those transactions being recognized, because they typically will always occur at carrying value, and it, any differences would logically be actually be, you know, accounted for through the stockholders' equity. So we've tried to kind of, you know, look at various aspects here in terms of the accounting considerations when it comes to business combinations.
Thank you for this. Very, very useful. And we'll come back to you for some questions in the Q&A session.
Sure.
I want to move on to the valuation considerations, because whenever there's an acquisition, there are interesting aspects of valuation, especially the purchase price allocation. And for that, can I invite Rajesh Kherajani to give his thoughts? Rajesh, you have very few minutes, but we want to make sure we have some very interesting speakers ahead. So I would request you to be very brief. Thank you.
Sure. I'll quickly pick up from where Atul left. And I think a couple of things which is important. Once there is a business combination, like what Atul mentioned, wherein, you know, there is an acquisition of a business, whether it be through an asset acquisition or a stock acquisition, it requires a purchase price allocation report. And what I would be talking about is more of the practical, you know, questions that we have gotten from our client controllers and CFOs when there is an acquisition. Whenever there is a M&A, there is a need for, you know, having an opening date balance sheet, wherein your crux of the acquisition is essentially reflected on the day one balance sheet that you present. So if there are these customer relationship that you acquired or trade name that you acquired, which was critical to the acquisition, would be, because of the purchase price allocation, recognized on the day one balance sheet. So that is something which is very important. So I think that looking at the due diligence report, looking at a couple of press releases for us as practitioners, that is really important. And if you as an organization have had a due diligence report which talks about the reason for the acquisition, so then that economic reality will essentially be reflected on your balance sheet. The second most critical aspect that, you know, we have questions is the deal model. Many a times what happens is that there is a deal model on the basis of which the, you know, the transaction was closed. And many a times there is no deal model. So there is a requirement, because each of the GAAP, whether it be US GAAP, IFRS and Ind AS, thankfully they all talk the same language. So there is a requirement for you to basically have a deal model in place, or if not, because the deal was a part and parcel of a negotiation, reverse engineer a deal model, because that deal model will be an input, a critical input to many of the intangibles that you would be recognizing on the balance sheet date. So that is the second discussion that we have with our clients. The third thing, and I think this is very critical when we've discussed with our clients when they do M&A transaction, buy side, sell side, they look at the IRR for a deal. Many a times what happens is when you're doing a valuation for financial reporting purposes, there are two key terms which is a little different from how you typically view any acquisition. And those two terms are market participant and the highest and best use. So in a nutshell, what a market participant assumption does, and I'll give you an example. So let's say that you are an entity and your debt equity ratio is, let's say, 80-20, right? But a market participant assumption makes you to look at market participants that are basically peer group companies in your industry, and looking at their debt equity ratio as an example. And if they are, let's say, at a 50-50, so your intangibles will essentially be recognized based on those market participant assumptions. Again, the last concept which I would like to quickly touch upon is the highest and best use concept. Many a times what happens is that entities do M&A. They have this, let's say, for example, there is a brand name which was acquired. The acquiring entity does not see the use of that brand name for more than 1 year. So they could very well decide to write off that particular brand name for a year, after a year. What the gap says is that even if there are these entity specific intended use for a year, on an economic standpoint, if that intangible has cash flows which can accrue for 5 years, on the valuation standpoint, you would actually value those intangibles as if the cash flows would accrue for 4 to 5 years. And then based upon your group accounting policy, you can decide to write it off over a period of 1 year or probably on day one. So those are the typical, I think, inputs that I wanted to talk about when it comes to an M&A transaction, especially when it comes to financial reporting purposes. Over to you.
Well, thank you, Rajesh. Talking about nuances, I think a very clear trend, like I mentioned when I was opening opening comments, is the concept of earnouts, contingent considerations. We have seen almost each one of the India into the US outbound acquisition transaction, the structuring always involves an earnout. And the earnouts can be of different types. The most common earnout is revenue and earnings. And if one meets a particular threshold, both of revenue and earnings, one can certainly get the balance consideration. Now, this throws up some interesting opportunities. Now, traditionally it was 51% upfront and then 49% over 2 or 3 years. We have seen now little challenges there. One doesn't need to really go up to 51%. One can do 33 and then do a 3 year or a 2 year earnout and various constructs there. But when we talk to the deal teams and when we are talking to the buyers especially, I think the key is that the seller should have a skin in the game. We want the sellers to continue. We want them to ensure that we grow the business together. And to that extent, the risk is co-shared. Now, when you try to think about a construct which is contingent, this again throws up interesting, important aspects of accounting, tax, valuation. So I'm going to give 1.5 minutes each to Atul, Shishir, and Rajesh to cover the accounting, tax, and valuation aspects of how does one really think about contingent considerations, earnout payments, what should be measured and how. So on that one, Atul, over to you. Do you want to quickly just tell the audience about some nuances in accounting first?
Sure, Vaibhav. And I think, the key difference
is... Atul, you seem to be muted.
Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, Atul.
Yes, Atul.
Yeah, great. Yeah. Okay. So, when we talk about contingent consideration, I think what is not contingent consideration is something which we need to keep in mind. And definitely any payment which is made into an escrow account, okay, or a seller note which is provided. Now, that is not contingent consideration. One very, very important one, because this is something which impacts an EBITDA of an acquirer, is that if there is a conditional future payment, an earnout payment which is based and linked directly to continuing employment, subject to continuing employment, then that is deemed to be a post-combination service agreement and is not seen to be a part of the transaction itself. So that is a very important aspect, which sometimes, you know, kind of has an impact on the financial statements of acquirers. So I guess I would probably put down that to be the most important accounting consideration. Otherwise, all other contingent consideration in the form of earnouts, which are based on targets being reached, whether it is EBITDA, whether it is revenues, and so on and so forth, those are considered to be part of the business transaction, the business combination transaction, and so would need to be fair valued on day one, which is the date of acquisition.
Okay. Thanks, Atul. I'm going to, Rajesh, do you want to quickly talk about one important aspect of valuation that one should keep in mind when we talk about contingent considerations?
Sure. I think one of the points was already covered by Atul when it comes to whether it's a compensation or a consideration. There are a couple of other things, especially on the valuation standpoint, and I think that which is important. If it's, you know, whether the contingent consideration is cash settled or whether it's equity settled, that also determines whether it's a liability or an equity. And why it's important is that if it's classified as a equity, there is no subsequent remeasurement. But if it's classified as a liability, then it requires subsequent remeasurement. Again, you know, many a times as a part and parcel of the deal, there are matrices which are either financial matrices or non-financial matrices. Now, again, depending upon whether, the contingent consideration is structured as a financial matrix or a non-financial matrix, it's important as an input for valuation, because if it's a non-financial matrix, we say that, you know, it's basically something which is diversifiable, so there is less risk associated with it. And because of less risk, you can use a lower discount rate. So this is something that we generally, when it comes to valuing contingent consideration. Now, this, while it does not really provide, a complete, framework, but it covers most of the scenarios. And basically, if your metrics, if your parameter is non-financial or which is diversifiable, you typically use a scenario-based model, which we say that, you know, you can actually do a probability-based weighted average method to kind of value the contingent consideration. Even if the structure is linear with, you know, no thresholds or caps or tiers, you could again use a scenario-based model. So these two are relatively easy to value. But if there is a, you know, underlying metrics, which is a financial metrics, or, you know, if the structure and the structure has threshold caps and so on and so forth, or basically it's not a very linear payout structure, you use what we call it as an option pricing model. Now, again, there are, you know, situation wherein it's not just one matrix, but there are a couple of other, related matrices. It could also have path dependency, some clawback features as well. Now, that is something which is a part and parcel of your contingent consideration structure. You go to what we call it as a Monte Carlo simulation model. So, in a nutshell, this is what we do in terms of the evaluation aspects of contingent consideration.
Thanks, Rajesh. Shish, on the tax side, any special aspects to look out for?
Sure, Vaibhav. Very quickly. So, again, like Atul also mentioned, Rajesh also mentioned, the important point is whether it's a sell price versus a payment for services. So if earnouts are predominantly related with the performance of services, or if the performance of service is an important criteria, it is all the more probable that IRS is going to view it as a compensation than really a sales consideration. So the buyer's and the seller's perspective becomes very important, because the sellers would want to treat it as a capital gain, because that's a preferential tax rate they get. On the other hand, the buyers would want to mitigate the risk and want to treat it as payment for services, also given that it becomes a deductible expense for them. So how do you really bridge the gap and reach to a logical conclusion is something which is very important from a tax perspective.
Thank you, Shishir. I think, friends, these are the nuances when we are looking at, you know, acquisitions, accounting, tax, valuations. Let's now look at, you know, how does industry, you know, when we talk to practitioners of M&A across businesses, how do they think? And for this, we have two very interesting speakers. We have Biplab Chakrabarty from Tech Mahindra, and we have Saurabh Dwivedi from Persistent. I'm going to invite both of them to kind of share their views, share their thoughts. To start with, Biplab, It's a pleasure to have you, and thank you for joining us today. Just for a quick introduction, Biplab heads the M&A and the investment team at Tech Mahindra. And over the last almost a decade, he has done numerous acquisitions and investments across the globe, across industries. And I think, Biplab, your experience, your wealth of, all the nuances, the examples that you would have seen, I think the audience would love to hear from you. This is a free open session. What we felt is we want to draw from your experience and try and see how we should think better when it comes to acquisition. So with that quick overview, Biplab, over to you.
Thanks, Vaibhav. Hello, everyone. Good morning, good evening, wherever you are. I'm no expert. I'm just an executioner. We do deals. I think the experts have already spoken. But from our perspective, I think US always has been one of the key geographies that we have been looking at from an M&A perspective. We have executed quite a few deals over the last few years, and we see no reason to change that. I'm just going to touch upon a few things which I heard. I think one was the deal flow. Clearly, I don't know who was mentioning that. Maybe it was Vaibhav, it was you. But clearly, from a deal flow perspective, I totally subscribe to the view that initially in the first few months, we all thought, things are going to change dramatically. Because it was just a very different world we were all entering into, right? So the first one or 2 months, just trying to understand what potentially could be the impact on our business, our industry, and the overall economy. But I think as we went deeper into the COVID lockdown, maybe about April, May, I think we realized that clearly it's going to have an impact. But from an M&A perspective, it does throw some very, very interesting opportunities. And I think Vaibhav, you mentioned that. Clearly there are people out there who have finding their businesses heavily stressed. Does it open a few interesting opportunities for acquisition? Clearly, yes. But having said that, there's also a slight, nuance that probably we should all recognize. There are certain sectors of the economy which, frankly, you won't even realize we're living in a COVID world, right? So let me give a few examples. If you look at, let's say, the cloud infra space, the vendors or the practitioners who are, in the AWS space or maybe the Google Cloud or the Azure space, the entire cloud infra space, the cloud app space, so whether it's a Salesforce or a Workday. Those valuations, I don't think they have changed. Okay. In fact, they have just gone through the roof, and probably also because as an outcome of this new world that we are all living in, right, where everything is remote. We are doing this call not in person. We are doing this call remotely. So just this new reality that we are all facing from a business perspective, I think it has really given a fillip to a certain segment of the industry, and clearly that part of the business, we believe we are seeing some fairly, challenging valuations, if I may, as an acquirer. But having said that, there are also some very, very interesting opportunities out there. And we continue to look at assets across the spectrum. Other than that, I think the one thing which, I would like to cover in my initial remarks, and Vaibhav, please jump in and ask questions, but the other thing which I picked up was the earnout structure. Clearly, what we believe is just given the new reality, right? We believe the upfront consideration definitely is changing, probably south, moving towards the south, just for the simple reason that we want more of the payout to be linked to performance, whether it's linked to revenue, whether it's linked to EBITDA, whether it's just linked to the retention side of things. Clearly, that's probably one angle that we have seen changing. I think other than that, the other point I think which I picked up in some, I think that was the tax section. Clearly, when we're looking at the tax perspective, I think, and specifically on the US side of things, there's a very clear reason to consider the asset purchase side of things, because when you are looking at the asset purchase, clearly there's some very, very interesting tax benefits, right? And Vaibhav is nodding his head. You guys are the experts. But just for the broader team, I think what potentially happens is if you do an asset purchase, you just get some very beneficial treatments in terms of the accounting, tax accounting side of things, where you can, you know, amortize the goodwill and hence get a tax shield, if I may, out of it. So probably that's one thing to consider when you're looking at deals or assets in US. The other thing we have seen in some of our deals is the net operating losses or the NOLs that we talk about. Clearly, we need to do some diligence on that. There is some clear negotiation that will happen, because a potential seller would always want that built into the purchase price. And we as the acquirers have to be really careful that once the ownership changes, does it really give the new owner the benefit of that NOL? So that's probably one aspect we need to be really careful about. And clearly, you know, from a tax diligence perspective, one of the most important, you know, aspects. But again, if you structure it as an asset deal, again, the diligence side of things becomes that much easier, because you'll be taking over fairly next to nothing liabilities, right? So probably that's another reason to consider the asset purchase versus any other structure. So those were the quick things that, you know, came to me. Vaibhav, happy to take any questions.
No, thank you very much, Biplab. That's pretty useful. This is the real world. Love that. We'll come back to you with a few questions, Biplab. At this point, let me turn over to our second esteemed industry speaker. We have Saurabh Dwivedi. Saurabh leads M&A and investor relations at Persistent. Persistent Systems Limited needs no introduction. You know, they have created tremendous value. Today, it's over a market cap of over $1 billion. And Saurabh, I have known Persistent now for a couple of decades, and you know, it's been pretty interesting to you know meet everybody in your firm, and it's been a lot of learnings for all of us. But I think just in terms of, I think Saurabh, with your experience in commercial structuring, you know, you've done large ticket transactions, across geographies, US, Europe, Japan, India. Today in the audience, we have a lot of technology businesses that are looking at, you know, inorganic growth acquisitions across the frontiers. We'd love to get your thoughts, your insights. How should one think about this? And then we'll both for you and Biplab, we'll have some questions from the audience. So over to you, Saurabh.
Sure. Thank you, Vaibhav. And thank you, Biplab. It was great to hear your views also on the M&A transactions that you have done over the years. Actually, I wanted to kind of take a slightly different perspective, more of a business perspective of looking at M&A transactions. And so first and foremost, when any company approaches inorganic as a part of its strategy, what are the typical drivers, right? I understand that in the audience today, we do have a number of, SME technology companies, which may be potentially looking at growing their business in the US market. So there are a few experiences or learnings that we could share from our side over the years. The typical drivers that you would find are, achieving geo expansion and getting access to new clients. You could actually be looking at filling some technology capability gap. Those are typically the two most important drivers that you would hear from anybody in the technology industry when they consider looking at an M&A. And there are also these sort of different, I would say, a slightly nuanced kind of transactions which actually become quite prominent at times like what we are seeing currently. And this was also very prominent during the 2008-09 financial crisis, which followed the Lehman meltdown. And they pertain to doing these captive takeovers or doing these setting up centers of excellence for large clients where you typically use the current opportunity where clients and enterprises are looking to cut cost and improve their operational efficiency, that people like us, people from the IT services industry, and technology is probably the biggest driver of productivity. So in a simple economic equation, you could drive productivity through capital, labor, or technology. And technology, as we see after every crisis, becomes the most important driver of that productivity. So I think Biplab did touch upon it, that the industry actually has seen, after a little bit of a concern for a couple of months, the industry actually saw that there's a lot of business to be done with all kinds of clients and enterprises looking to move to the cloud, looking to do more with the data that is available in their ecosystem, and trying to come up with new ways to reach out to their clients. So in this context, one would want to consider looking at potential inorganic opportunities if there are certain gaps in their portfolio, or there are gaps in terms of presence in certain geographies. Because for the next 3 to 5 years, I think a lot of people in the industry would probably believe in the technology industry that it's probably the cloud, the transformation to the cloud, and the data revolution that is going to happen in sync with it. I think that could be one of the biggest opportunities that the industry would have seen after a long time, maybe after Y2K. Those may be very strong words or very big words, but at least last few quarters for us at Persistent, we do have seen very good growth. And I think the same has also started reflecting in other companies, the tier ones like Tech Mahindra in our space as well. So that's a quick overview. And I think coming to that point about what are the kind of valuations we are seeing in the industry, and what are the new things which have happened and which one may want to consider when you look at your strategy for M&A. Clearly, the amount of money that has come into the global markets following the quantitative easing that big economies and global and developed markets have done, that has clearly pushed up valuations, not only in the public markets, it has pushed up valuations in the M&A market as well. And when in the first couple of months, we also thought that, you know, we have suddenly entered a phase where there may be good bargains to be had. But actually, we found things to be on the contrary. Good companies, which are growing well, which are profitable, are not available at a discount. If anything, the premium has gone up. And so it becomes very important to understand what is it that you are buying? What is the value of the business that you are buying? So, I mean, I would like to maybe throw in a little bit of a quote here by Ari Emanuel, who was the CEO of Endeavor, a media and entertainment agency. And he said the following: I have never cared for what something cost, but I always care for what it's worth. I think that becomes very, very critical in evaluating M&A in the current world. Otherwise, otherwise one could find it very difficult to actually execute and close transactions if one were to be very conservative in approaching these kind of transactions in today's market. There could be a lot of opportunities which one could catch on in the next 3 to 5 years. And one needs to be prepared for it. I think the other thing which is happening in the industry is the kind of visa restrictions we have seen of late. And even though Mr. Trump is hopefully going out, if he agrees to go out, but even under Biden, I think there would be a lot of pressure on him to ensure that the local employment starts looking up. So who knows, there may not be a lot of visas which may become available to Indian companies, or there could be. But I think going forward, the companies would have to evolve their businesses where they evolve their business models in such a way that you know, they look to hire local talent in the North American market. That is the most important market for IT services company out of India. You could address those requirements out of Mexico, Canada, and there could be more offshoring as well, given that we all can today work from anywhere in the world. So I think some of those considerations would also potentially drive the kind of M&A opportunities that companies would consider going forward. There could be companies which may actually be doing very good work with US customers, but probably doing it out of Mexico or Canada to be in the same time zone, even Eastern Europe, where some differentiated talent would be available to go with the kind of talent we already have at large numbers in India. I think the only other thing I would say, and I don't want to take up too much time because I think we would probably have another 3-4 minutes before we want to go into the Q&A, is if some of you are doing this for the first time, then please be very, very careful in your approaching this kind of an exercise. It's probably very good to, it's probably, you know, I can't say this more, but you probably need to be having good trusted advisors on your side, like the ones you have on the call today. You should also invest in possibly building a team, even if your business is small. Please invest, please see if you want to do this, more of this, these kind of transactions going forward, please invest in a small team to institutionalize the knowledge within your company, so that whatever learnings you have from these kind of transactions, you can use them going forward. And also start small, do smaller transactions to begin with. You can build and understand, build a lot of knowledge, understand a lot of nuances, and try and integrate them for the first couple of years before you really set your eyes on big targets. And if things look too complicated in a particular situation, in a particular transaction, they look like a spider's web, better to avoid than to be sorry later. So I think with that, I think, and there's something which even Trump said, right? I mean, we often consider his comments in a very sarcastic, we probably perceive his comments in a very sarcastic manner, but there was something of very, a lot of value that he quoted. He's also a big deal maker, by the way. I mean, he's probably one of the smartest deal makers in the world. And he did say this, that sometimes your best investments are the ones that you don't make. So don't get emotionally bought into the transactions when you go into it. Work with your advisors, see if it makes sense, and be ready to walk away at any stage if it happens to be that way. So let me pause.
Thank you very much. You're right, 78% of acquisitions don't work. That's the data that we have been following. But how do you be in the 22%? How do you make sure that you make it work, create value? Before we jump into the question and answers, and we have a few of them coming in, I wanted to take 2-3 more minutes and get our panelists to kind of, you know, give, you know, there are concepts that we keep hearing. You know, there are concepts about SPAC, you know, special purpose acquisition vehicle. So what on earth is that? And Atul, if I could request you to just, in a nutshell, explain to us the SPAC. Why is it getting popular? Is it really necessary? How should one think about it?
So I guess, you know, bringing this topic in, because this is a completely new and a different form of, you know, an acquisition vehicle, which has become extremely popular in the US today, where, you know, people, let's call it technocrats with past experience, go to the market and basically, you know, get the funding for future acquisitions. So you set up a, you know, there are these, you know, individuals who go into the US market, invite, you know, money into their acquisition vehicles. And then they have got a time period within which they have to go and actually acquire targets. Now, there could be companies which might end up being targets. And one of the aspects that one needs to kind of keep in mind, when you become a target of a SPAC, or you are the, you know, you are the acquiree within a SPAC, is that if you are going to be the, or the target is the only target, and that is going to be then basically merged with the SPAC, then it logically becomes what is called as, in SPAC terminology, a predecessor in the transaction. Effectively, in that sense, then there are certain accounting requirements, there are certain audit requirements that a predecessor has to, you know, keep in mind, because it then becomes effectively part of a public company. Secondly, a SPAC, which is a special purpose acquisition, company, could go and actually acquire multiple targets. Now, if there are multiple targets, then there is a requirement as per the accounting, rules to basically identify one of those targets to be the predecessor in the transaction. There might be, specific or exceptional situations where there might be even multiple predecessors in a transaction, or in multiple transactions where there are multiple targets which are being acquired. Usually the way in which this is actually determined is normally because, of the size of the targets, who out of the target entities, ends up being the actual operating controlling entity within those group of targets. Some of those are the aspects which definitely come in when we look at, as to what is the determination of a predecessor. From a target perspective, some of the very important requirements that one needs to kind of keep in mind is that since you are going to be part of a merger proxy statement of the SPAC, there is a requirement that, and so now there are two things. If you're just a target, then you would need 2 years of your prior financial statements to be as per Reg SX. So that is, the big company, public company gap. And you're also looking at the application of gaps which are applicable to public business entities. So that would mean that, segment reporting, specific disclosures with respect to revenue recognition, all of those become applicable. If on top of that, if you are determined to be the predecessor, then in that case, apart from the accounting requirements, you would also require your audit to be conducted under the PCAOB standards and not just as per the AICPA GAS standards. So that is something which also companies which are going to be possible targets of SPAC need to keep in mind. Since we have a cross-border audience here, if your company is a foreign company and if your company is going to be a predecessor, then in that case, again, the US GAAP requirements flow in. If that is not the case, then you could even use IFRS financial statements or any other GAAP compliant financial statements, which could be even something like Ind AS. So these are some of the things that one needs to bring in. This is something which is extremely popular today in the US, apart from the PPP, which is an important element of a lot of the acquisitions nowadays. But SPAC acquisitions is also something which is, the name of the game nowadays, and something which companies need to kind of keep track of, because this is these are important players which are out in the market looking at good size acquisitions. And, this is something which I hope that Indian companies don't lose out on if they are the opportunity in such situations.
Thank you, Atul. That's very useful. I think these are concepts which I'm sure it will get more and more attention. And I think one would do well to kind of ensure that we optimize use of these. And even financing, we are hearing large ticket acquisitions where financing SPACs, they've found it very, very useful. In fact, we've had a Deliver case, bankruptcy situation recently where we just saw this apply very well. So again, with that, I think we have come to the end of some of the thought that we wanted to share. I wanted to get into questions, and we have got a lot of questions that have come. And I'm covering some of the other topics as part of these questions. So the first one, again, we'll turn back to our industry speakers. And Biplav, there's a question for you. You acquired a few companies recently. Were the valuations just at par, or were they lower than before the pandemic? You mentioned the increase and all of that, but keeping those aside, how did you see the valuations recently?
It's a tricky question. not because I don't want to answer that, and some of it could be confidential, but listen, to help the audience think, as I said earlier, and I think Saurabh also referred to it, some of the new age technologies or early stage technologies or, you know, the growing technologies, whichever way you want to classify it, whether it's the you know, cybersecurity side of things or the cloud side of things or the data analytics side of things, we definitely are seeing some fairly difficult valuations, if I may. And Saurabh, I see, is nodding his face. I you know, we share the pain. But you know, some of the others, I believe, clearly, I would say, you know, they are probably at par. Can't say they're at a significant discount. So again, I agree with Saurabh and his view. I don't think it's like, you know, everything has plummeted by 40% or 20%. So it's not like we are seeing significantly different valuations on the other side, you know, whatever we have been doing, which is probably, if I may call, our legacy business, if I just to classify it from some of the other things that I mentioned recently. But clearly, you know, what we initially thought in the first couple of months, that companies will be severely stressed and we'll get significantly lower valuations. See, because one thing we have to understand, the ones that are also very, very desperate to sell, you just have to be really careful, right? Are they selling because is it just a fantastic business model and they believe they can cash out? Or is it really because they don't believe that, you know, they have a good prospect? Or maybe the third, you know, third category could just be that they just want to sell out and probably be part of a larger organization like a Persistent or a Tech Mahindra, right? So there are different categories. And I think I really liked what you said, Vaibhav. Probably we shouldn't publicize it, that 78% fail. But the point is still valid that you really need to keep your eyes and ears open and ensure that the diligence is really up to scratch and the business case really stacks up, because otherwise you should just walk, never ever fall in love with an asset. I think Saurabh also touched on that point. So I don't know if I really answered your question, but I just wanted to give you a 360 degree view of how at least we are thinking. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Biplab. I'm going to just take a quick pause. This is for my colleagues, Mayank and Saurabh at NASSCOM. Did you want to run a poll in between before we move forward on the Q&A?
Yes, sure, we can do that.
Everybody has to click yes, right, Vaibhav?
Well, I saw this question for the first time. Absolutely. Well, you know, obviously at the end of the day, you know, it's all about sharing knowledge. I think we learn a lot, Biplab, when we have these sessions. So many interesting questions have come. And I'm sure, you know, as we move further, we will see some enriching conversations. Saurabh and Mayank, just let me know when I have to proceed.
No, I obviously, you know, I mean, there's a certain message there also, guys. I think, as I was mentioning earlier, the diligence side of things has to really stack up. And we definitely need advisors like you guys, okay, to step in. And when we start falling in love, just show us what the real ground reality is. So definitely the value that somebody like a Kena brings on the table is immense. Yeah.
Thanks,
Abhimanyu. You can continue, Vaibhav, now.
Sure. So this is a question now for Saurabh, again, from an M&A perspective, Saurabh. What are the recalibrations that your organization had to perhaps do post the pandemic? Did it really have an impact? Did you see it as an opportunity? So how are you seeing the post-pandemic M&A world?
So I think the recalibration is, like I said, we did initially think that there could be a lot of bargains available, but there were none to be had of any value, significant value. But I think what we have realized is that right now there is a lot of opportunity in the market. And next 12 months, and I think we saw, and there are a number of announcements which keep happening, right? In the last few days, we have seen TCS and obviously the tier ones and the TCS and of the world are in a different league altogether. But they've recently acquired a couple of captive centers from large customers like Deutsche Bank and Prudential and all. So in the next 12 to, and everybody will play in their own size and at their own level in which they, in the kind of deal sizes that they can play in. But the next 12 to 24 months could offer a lot of opportunities. I think the recalibration that has to be done is probably to bring in the right talent and also, you know, work together as a team over the next 12 months at a pace and with an with a focus where we can significantly accelerate the growth of the business during this period. And, you know, I think this transformation to the cloud the ability to now process workloads and do data analytics in the cloud is possibly going to, significantly go through the roof, right? And there would be enough for everybody to have. And I think the recalibration is only from, if I can give my firm's view, I think we just want to run the race faster right now. And, while there are others who will obviously, and there are biggies who will do big deals as well, we will just want to compete with ourselves and maybe see a much bigger and better self, better picture of ourselves in the next 3 years to 5 years time. I think there is a lot of opportunity and one needs to be prepared to just capture it.
Great. Thank you, Saurabh. One more question, both either to Biplab or to Saurabh, from an acquisition financing perspective. How to go about raising loan or debt funding if one is an India business? This is for acquiring a business in the US and considering that we may not have much collaterals to offer in the US. So any thoughts on debt financing, loan financing for Indian companies that are looking at US buys?
maybe I'll go first, Saurabh. So from our perspective, Vaibhav, we are slightly in a more favorable position just because, IT companies, as IT companies, we just generate so much of cash, right? So probably I will not be an expert to answer this question. But listen, having said that, I think there are very strong reasons to explore structuring the deal in such a manner where probably there'll be certain tax benefits that you can bring in on the table. And I'm sure, you guys will be the experts to answer that. But historically, just because of our cash balance, we really did not have to, look at financing. But definitely, it should be explored. Yeah.
Sure. Thanks, Biplab. Saurabh, did you want to add any comments to this one?
Yeah, the industry, typically, people have not really used debt capital to finance M&A in the past. But given where the interest rates are right now in the US and the fact that there is a natural hedge available to IT companies because most of the revenue is denominated in dollars, right? And a fair amount of expenses as well. So there could be an opportunity to raise, and I think the specific question was, even though we don't have hard, tangible assets on our books, but I think we could just raise debt if we wanted to, any of us, against the kind of cash flows that we have, because I think the lenders or the banks would draw comfort from the fact that we have a good cash book and a pedigree or a history of generating the kind of cash flow that we do. So it would be, and if that path were to be taken, it would be more from the perspective of interest rate arbitrage, I would say, that in US, we could probably borrow at 2%. And in India, we could still, even with lower interest rates in India these days, we could still possibly make 5%. So and if we don't have to hedge and maybe we don't have to hedge possibly because we do have a bit of natural hedge given our business dynamics.
Absolutely. Great. I'm conscious of the time. Maybe we'll take last two questions. Rajesh, a question on impairment. How are you thinking about impairment analysis in the new normal in the post-COVID world? just from, you know, if a business has acquired in the past, how do you think about impairment?
Sure, thanks. You know, we are actually, I would say we've got a 3 months head start because, you know, some of our clients in the United States have, you know, approached us because of their December filing. And we've had some lessons learned also when we did the March, you know, impairment testing. And I think that there were a lot of questions. And I think, you know, Biplab and Saurabh, you've touched upon that. That yes, businesses have evolved. We now know a new normal wherein, you know, we can actually work from anywhere. So I would say that, you know, this impact has essentially been, you know, nicely, you know, impact, you know, taken care of by just the change of the business model. Many a times, I think the pessimism which I see when we are doing an impairment, you know, approach, impairment analysis, the pessimism is more on the models, on the discounted models. But then when you look at the market-based multiples, you know, they have been at, you know, at nearing the all-time highs. So, you know, it's kind of, you know, a judgment call that we as appraisers need to really, you know, talk, you know, take. And I think as controllers and CFOs, I would say that get your auditors, you know, start the discussion with them ahead of the curve. You know, I have seen many of our clients, we've advised them as opposed to a one scenario model, look at a three scenario model, wherein you go with a base case, the worst case and the best case, and, you know, try to kind of model various scenarios into the way that, you know, looking at businesses. Have a recovery in mind. You know, you probably might be, you know, 6 months off for a complete recovery in terms of, you know, how much you are doing currently versus your 100% levels. So I think that is something that you need to really, you know, discuss and, you know, talk to your auditors so that, you know, the discussion is more on the business as opposed to the approach that one needs to employ. And like I said, you know, I mean, we did our impairment analysis for a couple of our clients in March. We discussed with the auditors, and rather than taking a March number, we actually did a multiples for, you know, a whole month, wherein, you know, it actually takes care of the impact of what a 31st March, you know, market multiple actually entails on your impairment. So I think the need is to be kind of have a pragmatic approach as opposed to, you know, just look at your, you know, standards and kind of, you know, look at impairment testing that way. And that is something, you know, the lesson that we've learned, Vaibhav, especially when we're looking at these businesses.
Thanks, Rajesh. Very useful. The last question, I'm almost over time. I'll take one last question because this is an important one. This is from Nishan Jain. How does one optimize taxation in the US? We have an entity in Delaware. We find taxes high. Nishan, nobody likes to pay taxes. We are hoping that the Biden administration also continues some of the low tax regime. But I would invite Shishir to perhaps throw some light. Shishir, how does one optimize taxes? You are a Delaware entity. Any practical inputs for Nishant and for everyone in the audience?
Well, I think Vaibhav, you made a right point that no one wants to pay taxes. And tax optimization is extremely important. However, what I would like to say is, I mean, it has nothing to do with it being a Delaware company because it's not really where you are incorporated that governs the taxes. There is one uniform federal tax rate, which is 21%, proposed to move up to 28% if Biden goes by his tax policy. What can be important to look at is the state taxation. So where you are really doing the business, where you know, where there are opportunities or where can you set up your businesses in a more tax optimal manner. So one, some of the states, I mean, obviously there are business angles to it, but there are certain states which have like 9%, 10% tax, vis-a-vis some states with a 4 or 5% tax. So are you good enough to do a business in the low tax state? And it can surely reduce your tax bill. Similarly, what are the different incentives, tax incentives which are offered by various states, such as the job opportunity tax credits and so on, the R&D credits, even for the technology companies, what you can take into cognizance to reduce your tax liability. So, you know, you need to think about various opportunities and possibilities really to improve or reduce your effective tax rate.
Thank you, Shishir.
We have, okay, Bhavtosh, I know you had put that question on OPC. So, you know, from an India perspective, you don't have a one-person company in US. If you were a US resident, sole corporation is possible. But yet one can do a single member LLC. One can do a single person owning the stock there. You don't need multiple shareholders or multiple directors. One person can open a company. That's the nuance. In terms of expenditures and compliance, I've already answered one of the previous question. It's all driven by your business plan, but a typical formation is between $500 to $1,000, not much expensive. It's important to plan it well. The foundation, if it's strong, you can really take the business forward efficiently. The annual cost will depend on, you know, are you going to have people there? Are you going to rent an office there? Are you going to have a marketing setup there? So the nuance of your business plan will determine what is the cost. But let me tell you, if you are in Mumbai or Delhi or one of the larger cities, the costs are fairly comparable. US is not anymore, you know, out of bound, out of reach. Very clearly, it is affordable. You have to plan it well. There are nuances of asset light models that you can examine. And, you know, once I have more details on your business plan, and happy to, you know, share our experience and expertise with you there. So please feel free to get in touch. Jairam, NOLs, even at the state return level. Shishir, a quick one on the NOLs at the state level.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you can use. So basically, there is a concept. So as you have a taxable income at a federal and state level, whenever you are incurring losses at the state level, you would be apportioning or you would be having losses at the state levels as well. So in the future, whenever you generate the state taxable income, you would have the state losses to offset that income.
Great. Thank you, Shishir. I think that was good. I think we have had some interesting questions, interesting thoughts. I want to thank Saurabh and Biplav, especially for taking out time, sharing their real world experience, looking at the other side of the desk, looking at acquisitions, collaborations. I want to thank all my panelists, Atul Deshmukh, Shishir Lagu, Rajesh Kherajani, for all your inputs on accounting, tax, valuations, the world of valuations. I want to thank NASSCOM for hosting a wonderful topic, a wonderful session, and also all my colleagues who have helped us set this up. With that, friends, feel free to write in. Feel free to kind of, you know, put your questions through. I know we had limited time. This presentation will be shared by NASSCOM. Feel free to go over it. And we are here to help you to grow your business in the US, both organic and inorganic. We would definitely come back with interesting topics from time to time. So keep a lookout for your emails. And with that, friends, thank you very much. Have a wonderful weekend ahead. And, think about growth, think about US. Very interesting Indo-US corridor business opportunities. All right. So good night, everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good night. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.